Hello, everyone. Welcome to season number one, episode number 11 of the all-new Wired Nerdy Podcast. My name is Keith. I am here with my good friend, Doug. How is this week treating you, Doug?
It's good. Sun's out. Weather's warm. It's starting to look like spring.
Good. Oh, man, it's beautiful. Beautiful outside. I'm loving it. It's that window in where we live where it's like perfection, but it doesn't last long.
So. Oh, yeah. I got to mow for the first time. You know that smell of fresh cut grass?
Oh, yeah. I've been doing a lot more outside work myself. So definitely, yeah, it's a nice change of pace. It's welcome. So
definitely.
Yeah, man. All right. Let's dive into this. So for this episode, it's going to be news heavy for the nerd news, mainly because a lot of stuff happened this week. And as we were building out the agenda, we realized, holy crud, we can't not cover some of this stuff. And so we were going to go through the nerd news first, and then we are going to talk about John Wick. We'll make sure we put spoiler alert in there before we get started. We won't ruin anything for you, but let's start off with our nerd news. I'm going to let you go first, buddy. Gina, just, you know, ceremonial. What do you got?
Discord is adding a soundboard, which I think is really interesting. We've used Discord before in some of our games, and the workaround to add music and to add sounds was really complicated. So I think this is pretty big news in that streamers and us simple folk can put in some music and put in some sound effects and just enhance our game that much more.
Yeah, it's pretty cool because, I mean, Discord's used pretty heavily by a lot of Twitch streamers, and they're really big into production value, and they'll, you know, do crazy things like sound effects and stuff like that. And I think it's cool they're doing it. You know, the thing that they haven't cracked, and I know you and I ran into this before, is when we would play a game, we would be on a Discord to communicate, and there was a bot that we had injected. I think we used Hydra. There's a billion of them. And it played music from Spotify. And I think it was a couple of weeks ago where they got their hand slapped, and I think I messaged you because I was like, oh no. They basically, I think it was Spotify, said that their music licensing did not extend to broadcast in game. I think in the event that, especially if somebody were streaming and people were watching, you know, like on Twitch. So I was hoping when this came out that, oh, maybe they solved a way from a licensing standpoint for you to play music. But no, but this is mainly sound effects. Is that correct? I mean, when I read it, that's kind of what it looked like.
Yeah, I believe so. Some of the examples are, you know, sad horn, crickets, drum noises, flatulence, you know, all the things needed to enjoy your game or your session or whatever you're doing.
All the fun sound effects of a shock jock, an old school radio host.
Yeah, that's kind of like, I think the Tesla, I'm getting off track here, but the Tesla, you can make it fart when people open doors and sit and stuff. So,
wow, it's been all that
Why
money.
That's needed, I have no idea.
Some engineer just decided to do it. That's right. pretty interesting. All right, let's go on to the next one. And the next one, I'm going to let you lead off with again, because it was a topic that you originally brought up not too long ago. Take it away. What's the next one on our nerd news?
Yeah, it doesn't surprise me at all that we talked about the Flipper Zero in a past podcast. I'm kind of looking for the article here. But Amazon is banning it because it appears to be a card skimmer. And for those who don't know, a card skimmer is a device that if you have the little chips in your card for wireless payments, it can steal the information off your card. Here's a Doug tip for you, is that if you go to a gas station and you see something suspicious on the card thing or an ATM or anything, pull on it. I mean, if it comes off, it might be a skimming device, because with 3D printers and stuff now, they're putting them right on the gas pumps and the gas attendants don't know. But kind of back to the story, this thing does the same thing. It gets close to somebody's wallet or pant leg, and it may be powerful enough to take that information off there.
Yeah, that's a really good tip. And I just read, similarly, there's a lot of these types of scams. There's something going on at airports specifically. If you've ever walked past an airport or a mall and there's a charging station for you to juice up your phone, you plug that bad boy in, they're finding that many of these things look legit, but they're not. And what they're doing is they'll put malware on and they'll steal your data off of your phone as well. So the advice there is to be cautious of those. Use a your own cables, number one. Number two, they do make data blocking devices that you would plug into the end of the phone and then the cable into, so then only power is allowed to pass through. Or the other aspect, which I'm a big proponent of, is just carry a battery bank with you if you need it. Now, most of these tips are for Doug because he's an Android user and his battery doesn't last all day.
No, it does not.
I don't have that problem since I'm a Mac user. I had to
I am a little jealous of that. My wife's phone never dies.
I know, man. We when we went to Comic-Con, that's what I was teasing him because I had used my phone all the way there. We played music on it. We had GPS to get to where we need to go. I used it all day for videos, photos. And I think like that night at 11, I texted him. I was like, yeah, by the way, I'm still at 37%.
I know. Yeah, we're getting off track.
I know. He doesn't want me beating up on him. But no, but the point is there's a really good write-up though on Gizmondo about this Flipper Zero being pulled from the market. And you had warned us about it before, and I hadn't even heard of it. And it points out that not only did what made this happen was the card skimming, but it says that the device can be used for tasks like opening garage doors, altering price signs at gas stations, unlocking car doors, intercepting Bluetooth signals, and even gaining access to someone's computer because it rolls through different frequency codes using RFID. And what you were talking about, that's why if you ever see like the Ridge wallet, for example, you'll see RFID blocking. That is so that if you don't know, traditional cards, not just the ones with the chip, have a magnetic strip in the back of them and they can be read with RFID from a device like this, which is ultimately why it got pulled. So we're not surprised. You kind of said that was going to happen when you brought it up.
Yeah, that's what I thought. I mean, it seemed too suspicious. It didn't seem like it had a good purpose to me. Now, I'm reading the article. The company's director or manager says it's not really Flipper's fault. That's not what he put it out there for. And that kind of goes with everything, to give him more credit that you make a device, you make it cool, but obviously somebody's going to use it for
nefarious,
intentions and nefarious reasons.
Yeah, we talk about that all the time with AI. So, but it doesn't surprise me. And the other fact that Amazon dropped it, I mean, think about the liability aspect. Because, yes, you made the product and you didn't intend for it, but there is some culpability. There is some accountability. So, I get why they pulled it. I think, it's cool what it does. I'll give them credit. It's so small. It's kind of neat, but there's always somebody out there that's got to ruin it for everyone.
Everybody, yeah.
Yep. All right, so let's move on to the next one. That was a good one. I'm also going to let you take this one.
Yeah, I've found some really good ones. You know, past couple episodes, I've been slacking, so I tried to pick up my game this week here. Now, this kind of goes back to our Steam Deck conversations. It looks like Rogue has released a possible like handheld called the Ally. Or Ally, A-L-L-Y, Ally. Mm-hmm. So it looks very similar to like a Game Boy, and it looks very similar to a Switch and your Steam Deck. I don't know what your thoughts are on it, looking at the design.
Yeah, so the ROG, I'm assuming I'm saying that right, line, they make motherboards. It's Asus is the company. And they make a lot of computer hardware, motherboards, you know, video cards, all kinds of stuff. So what's interesting about this are what really got people excited were the specs in comparative to the Steam Deck, which has been massively successful. And it says here that the early information suggests that Asus has joined forces with AMD to build a custom high power processor that contains or outguns anything that's currently, you know, on the market, including the Steam Deck. And it points out that, that the GPU, it says here that, you know, it's going to probably outpace it as well. It says that it'll run Windows 11 out of the box, which obviously opens up more games than Steam Deck. If you're unaware, the Steam Deck out of the box runs Steam OS, which is a Linux build made by Valve. And so you can put Windows on a Steam Deck, but it's not native to it. So you have to do a little bit of work, jump through hoops, and we'll talk about, there's actually a news article kind of that here in a little bit.
Yeah.
But the advantage is this one would have native, it looks like it's going to be 512 gig for the low end model at $649, and then 1 terabyte for $899. So, you know, the fact that they actually reached up to a 1 terabyte model is good because the Steam Deck only topped in at 512 on their top end model. However, the real question is this going to be as moddable or as upgradable as the Steam Deck? Because as you know, I got like a 2 terabyte in my Steam Deck. Yeah. So, you know, that's one of those things. So I think it's cool that this market's opening up. I think what the Steam Deck did, you know, it all started with the Switch. The Switch showed that handheld gaming, there is a market for it and you can make money at it and there's demand and there's an audience. The Steam Deck is now taking the computer game library on the go. And I think that other companies see this and like, oh, hey, let's do better specs. Because let's be honest, the Steam Deck's amazing, but it doesn't have, they could have done better with some of the specs, especially since time's moved on and availability's gotten better. And a lot of people say that maybe there'll be a refresh of it, kind of like a pro version, who knows. But here's the one thing about this, though. The advantage that Steam has initially out the gate is their library of games. Now, if this is running Windows, you can run Steam. So they're kind of circumventing or getting around that one advantage on that. But competition's good. That's ultimately my thought. I think it's great. Competition's good. I will say this, though. I love Windows. That's great. But I'll tell you what, man. There's some really good efficiencies with Linux, and gaming on Linux is getting better and better. And part of the reason why they stuck with SteamOS is because the efficiency gains that they can tweak and do, they don't have that control over Windows. So that gives them a little bit of an edge to an extent, as long as they continually iterate and you know, advance it and develop it. But we'll see where it lands. So those are my thoughts.
Yeah. It definitely looks good. I don't like the design as much as the Steam Deck. It just looks really nice. Plus, the covers that you can put on it, like you put that PlayStation cover on it, looks great.
Oh, so, the wraps. Yeah, the wraps.
The wraps, yes. Yeah.
Not which the I'm covers, sure you yeah. could probably wrap this. You know, the real kicker to me on all of this is heat and battery life. The battery life on the Deck is okay if you're doing, like, today's games, like high-end games, it doesn't last very long. I mean, you're looking at 4 hours if you're lucky, depending on what
sounds
your graphics
like an Android
are. It kind of does, but if you're doing stuff like you can use the device to, you know, stream from your gaming computer, or I do a lot of retro gaming on it, the battery lasts a really long time. If you don't put the processor on a heavy load, it will really last quite a while. So it depends on what you're doing, you know, but we'll see what these other manufacturers are going to do, and we'll see, you know, and maybe it'll spur Valve to refresh the Steam Deck a little bit. So competition's good ultimately, in my opinion. So
sounds good. So do you want to we're looking at a list here, let's skip ahead to the Windows handheld mode. Do you want to talk
might
about
as well
that?
Since we were just talking about it, yeah. This is a good find by you, by the way. Apparently Microsoft is experimenting with Windows handheld mode for the Steam Deck, which we were just talking about. I hadn't even seen this until you had thrown this on our list. So essentially, it looks like, so a lot of corporations, especially tech companies, will have these initiatives internally where they will call them a hackathon, which is a term that just basically you get all of your developers together and anybody can brainstorm and throw ideas against the wall. Oftentimes they make it fun and they'll say, you know what, you have 48 hours to come up with a concept and build a pilot. Well, it sounds like this was the byproduct of an internal Microsoft hackathon where a group of employees got together and like, well, how can we make a version of Windows that would work best on the Steam Deck and handheld? And apparently it went so well that now they're talking about, you know, maybe how can they have this go to market. Well, where this is good is because while you can put Windows right now on the Steam Deck, there are driver issues you got to get around. You don't have native built-in controller support, all kinds of stuff. Well, if Microsoft gets on board and they start making it easier with driver support and having a handheld mode, that's really good for the Steam Deck. However, that's also really good for the handheld like Asus is building and others. So everybody kind of wins in a way.
Yeah, it looks exciting. I mean, there's it just opens a door so much for what Steam Deck can do. So the second iteration, third iteration, fourth generation, whatever you want to call it, of Steam Deck and all these handhelds are going to be pretty amazing.
Yeah, and what you're seeing is this mobilization of PC gaming where you typically were tied. The most mobile you could get is a laptop, as you know. Yeah. This really blows it out of the water. So it's really kind of cool to see the industry developing this way. So
it's that was very interesting.
Good news find, man. Good news find.
All right. I'll let you take over for a little bit.
All right. My next one, we're going to get a little weird with this next one. So,
oh, sweet.
It's a news article off of Polygon. And apparently there's a clothing line. Now, there's always really weird fashion shows and clothing lines. We know that. But this is called Lowe's, if I'm saying that right. Low poly clothes. And they're really expensive. And I'll make sure, as we're talking about this, that I'll put some of these up. Essentially, they are shirts and skirts and pants and jackets that look like Minecraft or pixel art from like your 90s. 80s games, depending on what era you're looking at. But these tops, like the t-shirt top, basically goes for $1,850. You can get mini skirt that's $790. They have khaki pants, $2,500. And they have purses for $3,400. But essentially, they're just normal clothes, but it looks like on the actual clothing, they put pixel art on it to make it look like pixel video game art. It's really weird. So,
yeah, I'm looking at them, and some of them, they are hard to tell that it's actual clothing and not like a clip art or a picture or something.
Yeah.
The price way out of range for me. I'll stick to my normal white t-shirt.
Okay, if it was $10 at Walmart, would you even
buy absolutely.
It?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's hilarious. Imagine Doug in a pixel shirt. I love it.
That would be awesome.
Okay.
I got to wait for the price to come down a little bit.
I know. That's a little pricey. A little pricey. All right, so let's go on to the next one here. And the next one kind of ties into our conversation we're going to have on the main line here in a little bit, and that is Peacock made an announcement that they're going to do a John Wick prequel called The Continental. Not a lot of details are known about it. The trailer is very short, but essentially it is focused on the actual hotel in New York. Because remember, if you know the stories, it shouldn't be a spoiler, there are different bases that are hotels all across the world for assassins. The one in New York happens to be called the Continental. And I guess it's the origin story about that and telling more stories. So,
yeah, it looks really good. It's unfortunate. And I pay a little respect to the concierge, Sharon, I believe, played by Lance Riddick. Lance Riddick passed away. Just this year. That's unfortunate. He played a really good part in the movies. So it'll be unfortunate to kind of see him not be able to continue that.
Yeah, it'll be interesting. And we don't know what era it's in or if his character will be recasted, but younger. Just not really sure what's going to happen with that. But if you are a fan of John Wick, I encourage you to check it out.
Yeah.
All right. You want me to keep on trucking?
You're doing great.
All right. I gave you the bulk of the first one, so I'm going to keep on trucking ahead.
I'm shining. I need to keep it up next week.
So what's interesting about the next one that we have on the list is something that we've not really seen before, which is tied into the crossover between the TV show and game of The Last of Us. So what they did was Naughty Dog, the developer of The Last of Us, has issued a patch that adds HBO t-shirts into the PlayStation 5 and PC game versions. Essentially what that means is that, in casting, when they filmed, they had different t-shirts on for the characters, same characters. But they took those same t-shirts that they had on, for example, Mortal Kombat was one of the ones that was listed. And they created a match. So when you play the game, it's going to match the TV show now. I've never seen a game company go back on a property and do a patch to adapt so that those two things meet up. So I think it's cool. What are your thoughts on that, man?
Yeah, it looks really cool. I mean, it's a great way for them to advertise some of their shows. HBO's have been around for a long time. That's a whole nother podcast, but really good shows. And it's a great way to say, hey, you're watching this. Check out this other stuff we got you may not have heard of.
Yeah, it's really cool. It's talk about cross promotion and just going back. And it kind of opens up to like, what are the things can they go back and patch and reintegrate into, whether it's storylines or just matching clothes and that sort of thing. So I think that's, I don't know. I've never seen anything like that before. So I think it's kind of cool.
Yeah. And we talked about it last podcast. That kind of changes my mind of instead of, releasing those old games where they never patched it, this is a cool thing to do. Releasing a patch to add more content. So I kind of go back on what I talked about last podcast of why do they keep patching and it's not good from the go. So this is one of those positives, I think.
It is. And it can also breathe life into a game, you know, especially, you know, people pick up games at different times in its life cycle. Like, look at you. You picked up Skyrim, like, how many years after its release?
And there were so many mods and stuff.
I could start
from day one.
Well, in a way, that's almost, there's a beauty to that, because you can experience the holistic big picture of it in its most mature state versus if you were an early adopter, you beat the first time, then they add all this content. You got to go back to it and revisit. And then on top of that, you got continuity. You got people just getting into a video game. Like, you're going to play The Last of Us. Because you saw the TV show. Well, now you have a connection, a continuity between the two because of the clothing. I don't know. It's an interesting marketing thing that I've never really seen them do before.
Yeah, I like it.
All right. So the next one is tied to a whole series of announcements that are kind of pulled together. The biggest thing is it's about HBO Max. So they had an event this week and they made an announcement. And this had happened, you know, about a year ago, where there was a bunch of mergers where HBO Max really was HBO and I think it was Discovery. They had come together as a company, but everybody was like, well, what's going to happen with it? And Discovery had Discovery Plus, which was their own streaming service. It's things like, you know, The Deadliest Catch and Dirty Jobs and all those very, very popular Discovery type shows. But it hadn't been doing so great. Well, they announced that they're going to merge the two libraries together. They're going to rebrand. It's no longer called HBO Max. It'll just be called Max, which is funny because the internet's been criticizing that because it's such a generic name. I think their concerns were whether or not they wanted to have the HBO included because it has a certain brand and it's going to have non-HBO content from Discovery on it. So I think there was a lot of debate from what I read in making that marketing decision. They are going to change the app. I know I got an email already where they made an announcement, said, hey, you don't have to do anything. We're going to move all of your profile preferences over. What I don't know is if it's going to be an all new app or are they just going to patch the existing one, and they are going to do some interface changes. So I don't know. As long as they don't increase, it didn't say they were going to increase the price line, at least for existing customers yet. They may. As long as they don't do that, that's fine with me. And there's some good Discovery shows. You know, personally, I love The Deadliest Catch. I never finished a series. Maybe this will be my chance to do it. What are your thoughts on this, Doug? Do you have any shows that stand out to you, or what are your thoughts on this merging? Do you think it's good, bad? Because, I mean, HBO Max has been doing awesome. They've been doing really well. So what do you think?
They've got some really good shows. I like it. I kind of hope that, I've got two thoughts. I would like to see one app where all the shows for HBO and Discovery are there, but they have such a huge library that it might be worth separating the two. That way you kind of know HBO branded shows and movies are on this one and then all the Discovery stuff. Because like I said, their libraries for each service is so huge. So
they said they're going to break it up.
They should go.
Well, they're going to break it up by themes. They did say that.
Oh, okay.
So they'll have like HBO content, Discovery content, Warner Brothers content. So they are going to do that. That'll be hell. What's really confusing about the messaging is that they're still going to have, in the United States at least, a separate Discovery Plus. Meaning that if you didn't want Max with all the other content, you just want Discovery, you could still do it. I don't get why. That's interesting to me. So I don't know.
That is.
I don't know why they're doing that. So who knows? It could be contractual. There's always some kind of legal stuff behind it. But now they did do a slew of announcements in conjunction with the rebranding. And one of the ones I just thought was so interesting because we haven't heard from this intellectual property in forever is they announced that with this merging and becoming Max, one of the shows, and there were quite a few that they had announced that they're going to be doing, that they're going to bring back the Gremlins as an animated series. It's like the myth of the Magwai or something like that. So I thought that was interesting because there something has not been done with the Gremlins in a very, very long time. So that was kind of shocking, you know, like why that, you know, and how many of those things are they sitting on that they have the rights because now they're such a big conglomerate that they may pull out of their bag just so they don't have to come up with something new.
Yeah. Gremlins is such a strange movie, but it's also awesome. I like it. I hope it's as good as the originals.
I hope so. There's a hilarious Key and Peele that they have.
I think I've seen the same one.
It's a skit. If you don't know who Key and Peele are, think of it like an SNL kind of thing. But these guys are hilarious. And they do this whole scene where they're like executives in a boardroom in the 80s, and they're trying to follow up with Gremlins 2. And what are we going to have them do? And everybody's pitching ideas. Well, maybe we can have the Gremlins do this or that. And one guy comes in and he's like, all right, we're going to have a gremlin and it's going to be a girl. And like all of these crazy ideas. And one gremlin is going to be a spider. And he goes, all these. What's funny is this whole clip is funny, right? But then at the end, they point out all of that stuff was actually in Gremlins 2, like the weirdest off the wall, like any suggestion they threw at it, they just ran with it. So yeah, it's worth checking out if you ever get a chance. Just go out to YouTube, you'll find it.
Yeah, great.
All right, let's see here. We are getting down to our last two. All right, they're all Sony related. Love me some Sony. So this is interesting. Sony, a lot of rumors going on with them, is making a push for cloud gaming, and there's combined rumors with that I'll mention here in a moment. So where this is essentially coming from is that Sony had made an announcement where they're going to be hiring some full-time employees, specifically engineers, to focus on the whole cloud gaming strategy of the organization. Now, this is interesting, and it comes at a very unique time, because if you remember, it was only a few months ago that Stadia, done by Google, went down the tubes. Mm-hmm. They shuttered the project. And Stadia was good. It worked well. And keep in mind, if you're unfamiliar with this, this is essentially like Netflix, but it's streaming a video game out of a data center from the cloud to your device, home, really anything has an internet connection and a controller. So, you know, Stadia didn't go well. Everybody said, oh, this is the next big thing, because you can save all your money, not have to buy a PC. You can just pay a subscription, have access to all the latest, greatest games with the best graphics. But Stadia went away. Well, now Sony's starting to ramp back up. Some are anticipating that Sony sees this as an opportunity for them to capitalize in the market space, since Stadia is no longer in, so there's less competition. They did have what was called PlayStation Now, and so Sony had kind of, it's still around. They lessened it. They made it a part of their streaming service option. And all it does is it streams old versions of Sony games like PlayStation 1, PlayStation 2. I've tried it. It works really, really well. So they're ramping up. Now, this announcement of these, you know, postings and their strategy refinement came around the same time that somebody leaked that Sony is also looking at potentially getting into the handheld market again. Now, the Sony Vita was a huge success, believe it or not, and it really did a good job. Now, while the Nintendo DS always kind of stayed at the forefront, this is all pre-Switch, mind you, the Vita still has a cult following today, and everybody loved the Vita. They loved the hardware, and it was a great device, but there's theories about whether or not the cloud streaming effort may tie into somehow the handheld. And there's companies like Logitech. They released a handheld that's all, it's cloud gaming. It's all that. So it's interesting. This just shows movements and plays in the gaming industries and when it comes to streaming as to what's going to come next. So what are your thoughts on cloud gaming, Doug? Would you do it?
Yeah, and I think it'll give those an opportunity to play these Class A title games that when they don't have the hardware to support it. So I think it'll add way more players to the game and way more opportunities to experience all these great titles.
I also think there's a trend here with what you had brought up earlier with Asus getting into the handheld market. Microsoft now all of a sudden is looking to have a version of Windows as handheld. Sony's talking about a handheld. Yeah. What? So I think it's no coincidence that this week we're seeing a trend emphasis on handhelds.
Definitely.
I think they're all interconnected and related. And I think they're probably, it's a tit for tat kind of a thing where they're going at each other and trying to, mm-hmm. you know, feel each other out in that space. Cause I think the deck really proved that there's a larger marketplace there that maybe the Switch didn't prove. And that's mainly because Nintendo has kind of their own niche audience And the Switch is amazing, don't get me wrong. But being able to do what Steam has done with mobilizing their library, I think that's really kind of opened up these companies going, Sony, for example, our back catalog, we could really, what if we streamed? Oh, yeah. You could have every single PlayStation 2, PlayStation 1, PlayStation 3 game on a handheld.
No, I would definitely have to pick it up then.
I mean, that would be cool.
That's my entire childhood.
In your pocket.
Awesome. Yeah, I think to kind of wrap this up, the competition from each company is only going to make each product better. They're going to see what this company did, see what that company did. Ooh, hey, we could do that on ours. So it's really going to reward us nerds and geeks and fans and gamers to get really good hardware and really good stuff in the future.
Yep. And our last one on the list is also about Sony. They have made a sizable investment into Raspberry Pi boards. Those are known as SBCs. Those are single board computers. Raspberry Pis are very, very popular. I know, Doug, you have one inside of your arcade. Is that right?
Yep. And I've got a solo one that I might be able to show for the group here in a second.
Yeah. So the investment, let's get specific about what it is. It's a, quote, strategic investment. Now, Raspberry Pi is a separate company from Sony that's based out of the UK that developed it. And the idea was to bring as powerful as possible computers to a market as cheap as possible for education purposes, is how it originally started, on something that's about the size of a credit card. And these things are powerful. They can do some really cool stuff. They're using what's called RISC-based processors. If you want to find it, Doug, go ahead. And I can also throw up pictures as well. So the reason for their investment is that Sony has an artificial intelligence chip that they're wanting to integrate onto the board. They call it Atrios. It's A-I-T-R-I-O-S. It's Atrios Edge Computing on Chip AI Platform for image sensing for things like facial recognition. So did you find it?
Yep.
Yeah. So if those of you that are watching, that's what that bad boy looks like. Look how small that is. And we'll also have pictures up too. For those of you listening by audio, think of a bunch of cards, like a deck of cards. It's about that size. So, and it has multiple ports on it. It has like four USB ports on it. It's got a RJ45 network connection on it. You can plug that thing in. You can put video games on it. You can run digital signage with it. Some people do home security. I mean, they're pretty impressive. But what Sony's wanting to do is to integrate their AI. Again, Doug, we couldn't get away this week without mentioning AI.
I know. It keeps coming back.
So Sony's chip is specific to AI imaging. Where this is a big deal is edge computing. Now, what that term means, you'll hear the term Internet of Things and edge computing. That's a fancy way of saying that when you have devices that are on the farthest edge of the Internet, for example, at a business, if you were to have a bunch of security cameras, and you wanted those security cameras to do image recognition for maybe people that shouldn't be in the store, things like that. These devices could run that. And they're so small, you don't need a full-blown server. You don't need even the cloud. You can put these computers at the edge right next to the camera or the camera hanging off of it, and it will do the analytics of capturing images. But it can also do image recognition with objects as well. You know, you own for your home, you have a security camera, and you showed me recently the wind was blowing around, right?
Yes.
And in the footage, you can probably tell it better than me. What happened in your footage? And I want to point out what happened with the green boxes in motion. Like, what is that? Because that is running on one of these Sony chips, by the way.
Yep. So there's multiple cameras out there. I have what's called the Wyze system, W-Y-Z-E. Really affordable, cheap, not a brand plug, but I like it. It has settings
you're hoping for a sponsorship there, aren't you?
Yeah. Hey, I take a new camera. So it has settings in there to detect dogs, people, packages, strange sounds. It even has for a nursery, like baby cries. It'll let you know your baby's crying and stuff. So the other day we had a very strong, I don't know, it had to be a little microburst.
It's like 50 mile an hour winds.
Oh, all of a sudden I get a notification and I see my barbecue grill flying across the patio in the backyard. But the green box you talked about, it was tracking that some big object, it couldn't detect it, the AI couldn't.
It was a movement.
Was falling over and moving. So
now you get a notification from that, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
So it's some of the notifications, I get too many with bugs, and I've seen a lot of wasps and bees and
building nests. But that's a great example of what Sony's wanting to capitalize on here with this announcement, is they're wanting to take that same chip that's used in devices like that, and they're wanting to pair it with the Raspberry Pi's computing power, which this is, it's pretty cool. Pretty big deal.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right. I think that does it. Is that all of our news? I think we've got through the hype.
Yeah, it was a good week. Lots of stuff going on.
Dude, man, we're 35 minutes in. You know, we got this. So we're going to round this bad boy out with a review of John Wick. For now, this is your spoiler warning.
Yep. Spoiler alerts. Yes. Yep.
So if you haven't seen it and you plan on seeing it, pause the podcast, go listen to one of the ones in the back catalog. I say that all the time. We got plenty of stuff out there now. We're on episode 11. There's no excuse. You can listen to us on anything. Make sure you like and subscribe on all the cool stuff that we have, both whether it's YouTube or in Spotify. But we do not want to ruin a good time for you. These are great movies. This is your spoiler alert. We're going to move forward now. So we're going to assume that those of you that are with us have seen it. I got the opportunity to see it. You saw it. Doug and I thought it would be a great opportunity to kind of go over this. Now, these movies, I love all of them. I just got to give that, you know, disclaimer. I knew it was going to be good going into it, and it really was. So right out the gate, my overall impression, chef kiss. Great movie. Every time I think they can't kill people in unique ways, they do it in the most insane ways. I still remember from like the second movie, he hit a guy with his car, and as he's rolling on the windshield and through the roof, he's shooting him through the windshield and the roof.
Yes.
And I'm like, oh, wow, how are they going to top that? And then they just over the top stuff. So that's my take on it. Like, I was just impressed with the movie itself. It's a long movie, isn't it? Like close to 3 hours.
I believe so, yeah.
Yeah, but I didn't feel like it. So what was your thoughts on it? What's your impressions, first of all, of the franchise? And then what did you think of this installment?
So the franchise is really good, I think. And a little background into Keanu Reeves. He went to a place called Taran Tactical, T-A-R-A-N Tactical, to do all of his weapons training. They actually make custom John Wick guns. They have a Pit Viper 1911 I'd love to have, but a little out of my price range. But I mean, they're using actual training, tactical and weapons and stuff to make him a better actor in the movie. And that, you kind of see all the behind the scenes stuff, and he shoots so many people. I don't know what the body count is, but it's
amazing. We did that last time, actually, and I put it up. So we don't know.
Perfect.
Actually, if you wanted the body count, I think we talked about it last time or the time before that, mainly because he had gotten t-shirts for all of the stuntmen. Yes. That's what it was with their, how many times they've been killed in this film. And that got us into talking about body counts. But you do bring up an excellent point. And if you can't tell everybody, Doug is definitely a gun guy. What's so cool about Keanu Reeves is that he started this even in The Matrix. The dude commits. He actually learned Kung Fu for The Matrix. The dude knows it. And there is footage. I'll try to find it. I'll put it on top of this video of him doing the training at that facility Doug's talking about. He's actually having to draw quickly, reload quickly, and actually hit the marks like where they're supposed to. You know, so for an actor, the dude commits, and what he's doing in the movie, he can really do.
Oh, yeah. And this goes back to, this is just a little rant here, but I don't like the movies, and I know we've talked about it, where you have a 30-shot revolver and stuff. I mean, I'll move on, but it seems to be pretty accurate to what the gun can do and what a person can do with it.
Yep. I was counting. I recognized at least one of the guns that he had. And I remember in this movie particularly, I was in the movie theater. I'm thinking, I was counting the rounds that he fired.
Yeah.
Sure enough, it was spot on. It was spot on to what it was. And I appreciate that, you know, because it kind of helps keep you into it. Now, they go over the top. They'll do like, there's a scene in one of the earlier films where they're walking through a mall and they're shooting at each other with silencers. Somebody overlaid on top of what it would really sound like, which is way louder. Instead of a... It's more like a more of a bang. You notice,
it's even though it's more of a suppressor than a silencer.
Exactly. Yeah. So there is that Hollywood, you know, aspect. Now I bring that up because the next thing I wanted to talk about, because I didn't know anything about it. There is a scene in this movie, and they do like a product plug in a weird way, where these guys, these henchmen, are arming up, and they have these rounds called dragon breaths, and they were using them in shotguns. And this scene was one of the most beautifully shot scenes in action we've ever seen. It's top down. So, you know, yeah. They built a set with the walls and it's dark, it's nighttime, but these dragon breath rounds essentially shoot what looks like sparks really far out, like a flame when it's fired. And all of these guys are rushing at him. And it, what's beautiful is that not only does he, it lights up the whole room. It's just, it's like combining fireworks with an action scene.
It was really cool.
And they set him, it set some guys on fire because they like had accidentally stepped through like some gas or something. And when he hits them, they light on fire. So there's stuntmen running through, they're on fire screen. It's just a gorgeous thing. He fires through walls and mirrors and the fire goes through the wall and catches these guys on. It's incredible. Here's the thing. My wife leans over to me and she goes, "Is that a real thing?" And I'm like, "Well, I know there's tracer rounds." And then it was only later I got on YouTube, went down the rabbit hole. Oh my God, it's a real thing. And then I find out you have actually gotten to shoot them before. Doug, yeah. What's your experience with dragon breath rounds? What are they? Why would you need them? Why were they developed? What the hell? It's so cool, though.
Yeah. I don't know why they were developed. Maybe just kind of a cool thing.
Cool factor.
We can tell people that Dragon's Breath is an incendiary round. It's illegal in like California, New York, kind of those same states.
I didn't think about the illegal aspect of it.
Yeah.
Kind of like bump stocks, right?
You're shooting a literal flame out of your gun. And they come in multiple calibers. So I've shot it in a 45 and a 9mm.
What's it like?
And then...
is it kick?
It's a little bit. The shotgun is mostly where you have it at.
Yeah, I noticed that the... both not only in the movie. Here's what I was surprised at. The footage I saw of a guy that had a shotgun, and he was just in a field showing you on a dummy what it could do. And he actually put gas on the dummy and shot it and stuff. He had a shotgun, and the plume out of the shotgun was so far and long, it actually matched the film quite well. And that's what I was impressed with, was, you know, just how real it honestly was. And I think the lighting of it being dark really kind of intensified it, obviously the music, that sort of thing. But I was just, I didn't know those rounds were a thing. And I thought that was so cool that they incorporated that in. And I never even heard of it. So I'm sure there's tons of people after seeing that movie there's going to be a run on dragon breath rounds if it's legal in your state. Kind of like, is it like a bump stock? A bump stock, if you don't know, is an attachment on a mod on a gun that when you, it basically takes a gun, makes it fully automatic, and you pull it to yourself. It's got a spring in and makes the trigger kind of go back and forth. Those are legal in some states, legal in some, or are they illegal?
They're illegal everywhere now by the ATF. So those don't really manipulate the trigger. They kind of manipulate your body.
Okay.
You kind of hold your finger still, and that bump stock with the recoil kind of makes your finger go faster.
Okay. So it simulates it as if you were able to manually pull the trigger super fast. Got it. So, you know, I'm imagining, like, I get why they made that illegal, but the dragon's breath, I'm like thinking, you can't, like, unless you want to pre-cook your meat and you're hunting, like, what's the point of that?
Yeah. And so, I have to make a correction before I get in trouble. I said 9 and 45. I meant 4, 10, 12 gauge and 10 gauge.
Oh, for the caliber.
Shotgun rounds, for the, not pistol rounds. So that's my apologies.
No, that's okay. And that's probably because shells have whatever incendiary it needs for that to happen, that effect to happen.
Yep. So the mix is magnesium pellets and powder. And that's what's creating your flame and your spark. I believe I'm reading it burns up to about 500 degrees. Goes between 100 and 300 feet. So 300 feet, you know, is a football field. So, I mean, that is a long way.
That's a very long way. That's insane. 300 feet. You don't even, man. You know, there's going to be some idiot that's going to use it for home protection and burn their house down. You know that, don't you?
Yeah. I mean, we're not really a safety company, but please, if you want to go try these, do them somewhere where you're not going to set a field on fire, or a cat, or all the above.
Oh yeah, dude, it's, you got to be careful with that kind of stuff. Yeah, I'll
absolutely.
You don't want to mess around with that. But the rounds impressed me. I didn't know they were a real thing. The movie turned me on to them. It made the one of the coolest visual effects. My last question is, how hot, or does the barrels get hotter as a result of it? Because it seems like it's a sustained burst. Like, what are your thoughts on that?
When I shot it, it did. It's kind of like the tracer rounds. You don't want to shoot nothing but tracer rounds. That's when you see in the military,
they alternate every, don't they?
5 to 10, yeah, because mm-hmm. then you're just going to melt your barrel down.
And the point of a tracer round, though, is essentially so you can see where you're, the directional of where you're shooting at night or in dark times, right?
I don't know the exact history, but I believe the military used it kind of, this is where our most of our rounds are going at pitch black, then we can keep sending them.
Exactly. So it's more for tracking. I don't know if we have...
They are really cool to shoot off a pond. But do it in a safe direction.
Oh, that's, boy, that's dangerous. And it just boils down to, I can't think of a logical explanation like we can explain for tracer rounds for Dragon's Breath outside of it just being cool for John Wick. But it's awesome. It's one of the coolest scenes in the movie. Definitely looking for it. If you, of course, you shouldn't be listening unless you don't care. You're not going to watch it from a spoiler standpoint. But you can probably even find it on the internet, I'm sure. Now, here's the big question. At the end of this movie, John dies. I said it, he slumps over, and then they're, because he has a bad way to go, obviously, at the end. And then he's at the funeral, or at the cemetery, and it has on his grave what he said, foreshadowing, I was a good husband, and that kind of a thing. Do you think he's dead?
Yeah, I mean, it's a toss up. I think maybe we see his tombstone and he is finally free of his contract and free of all the high table chasing him.
That's what I think. I think he's alive, and I'm gonna explain why. The practical side is the amount of money those movies make are so good, and I don't see them letting him go very easily. Maybe he does want a break. I don't know, but it's a cash cow. Although they are dipping into the back catalog with doing things like the Peacock Continental series. But I just don't see them letting it go. I just don't see it. Cause they're huge. They're always big hits. That's one. But then two, from a story standpoint, the theme throughout all of it is that he wants peace since his wife died. He lost his dog. He's always wanted peace, and he had peace for a moment. But remember, that was under certain pre-context that he couldn't get out from under with the table. I think they'll say the only way that we can really guarantee it, cause the table still exists, and they'll always pull you back in. It's kind of like the old mob mentality. I think the fictional narrative explanation as well, we absolutely want to give him peace. So the only way to do that is to fake his death, let people think he's dead so they can't pull him back in. And then he'll, resurface at the right time. Did you stay for the after credit scenes?
I did not.
There is an after credit scene.
I just found out about it.
So there's an after credit scenes. You're not missing much. You can find it online. It's very quick. Essentially, it's the daughter of the owner of the hotel in Japan. Remember, at one point in the movie, she says to John Wick, you got to promise me that you will kill the guy that killed my father, and he's the blind assassin. So it's just that blind assassin getting ready to give flowers to his daughter, who he loves, and his main motivation in the story for getting out himself. And she pulls a blade out from, under her coat, and she looks like she's about to try to kill him, and then it goes black. So the story continues, doesn't include John Wick, but could it mean that it pulls him back in later? We'll find out.
Yep. Yeah, definitely lots of different avenues to go down. Maybe she'll have her own spinoff.
So the last thing I'll say about this, and I'll let you give your final thoughts on it. What I read was the original director's cut of this movie was over 4 hours long.
Oh man.
And they trimmed it down to 3. My wife said, is like, if they release that, I would totally watch it. Now we own all 3 of them. And so the fourth one, if they had a director's cut, totally would buy it, totally would watch it. Because this series is up there with Lord of the Rings as rewatchable. I'm not big on rewatching things, to be honest with you. But if it truly was that long, they had a lot of good content and they had to make some tough choices in the editing room. They did an impeccable job. Love it. And these are comic books, by the way. I have not read them, but they're supposed to be really good. That's the source material for John Wick. So great series. Kudos to them. Did a great job. What are your final thoughts on it, Doug?
Yeah, I mean, I do like guns. Not like a crazy person. Let's get that straight. But technical details in there and all the cool stuff is a really great series and really action-packed. And Keanu Reeves, I like him a lot. The Matrix, and I go way back to Chain Reaction. If you haven't seen that, check it out.
Oh, yeah. You are going back there.
But he has a really good history. I really like him as an actor and as a person. You know, I'm kind of getting off topic, but you read stories about John Wick being just a really down-to-earth great person. Or
Keanu Reeves.
Keanu Reeves. John Wick, too, maybe.
Maybe.
Don't mess with his dog.
Exactly. Yeah.
So exactly. Keanu Reeves, yes. Down-to-earth person.
He's very down-to-earth. He does a lot of kind things that service on the internet. You'll see a lot of stories about it. You know, I can go back further. Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah. So he honestly, he's a really cool guy. He does cool work. Great movie series. You know, all the writing, the story. I love action movies anyway. It's up there with me. So rewatch it if you've seen it. If you haven't seen it, go see it. Obviously, you know, at some point you may go back in after you've seen it, listen to this. We'd love to know your thoughts. So feel free to share them with us. Whether you're inside of the Spotify or inside of YouTube itself, we monitor our comments. And Doug, I think that brings us to a full round end of episode number 11, buddy. How you feeling?
Doing great. Yeah, we had so much news. I think it's only going to get better. Lots of competition in the handheld market. Lots of movies coming out. Lots of shows coming out. It's going to be a great summer.
It is. Your audio sounding great.
Yeah,
man. So we're going to sneak in for future as some of these films release, some of these games release. We're going to sneak in impressions of it. We have some upcoming guests that we're going to be lining up. And we are also going to be covering a retro game con that's coming up this month, believe it or not. So we've got all kinds of really cool things coming down the pipeline for episodes. So stay tuned. And we appreciate you joining us each and every week. And we appreciate the audience metrics have been very consistent. So, you know, we're hovering, you know, around last time I checked around the 36 to 38 mark of subscribers on YouTube, about the same in audio. So, you know, that puts us into, you know, the 60s time frame or metric. And so hopefully we'll continue to grow that and we plan to continue to promote. And we just appreciate everybody joining us every week. Doug, yes, parting definitely. Blessing, man. What do you think?
Yeah, appreciate support. Keep listening to us, watching us, learning with us, having fun with us, and we'll keep you entertained, hopefully.
All right, everyone. You have a great week, and we will talk to you next week. See ya.
See ya.